Good morning. Let's stand together. Put your hands together. We're going to sing louder today. There's a song that cannot be contained. There's a shout that breaks through every chain. God, we won't be silent. There's a faith that rises through the flames. There's a joy that chases the dark away. God, we won't be silent. And the greater the storm, the louder our song. We lift our voices, lift our voices. Make your praise so glorious, glorious. We lift our voices, make your praise so glorious. So glorious. There's a song.
There's a song that cannot be contained. There's a shout that breaks through every chain. God, we won't be silent. There's a faith that rises through the flames. There's a joy that chases the dark away. God, we won't be silent. And the greater the storm, the louder our song. Yes, the greater the storm, the louder our song.
Oh, sing it out now.
We lift our voices, make your praise so glorious, glorious. We lift our voices, make your praise so glorious. Stop singing. We'll never stop singing. We'll never stop singing. We'll never stop singing.
We lift our voices, lift our voices. Make your praise so glorious, glorious.
We lift our voices, lift our voices. Make your praise so glorious. Make your praise so glorious, glorious. We lift our voices, lift our voices. Make your praise so glorious.
So glorious. So glorious. Come on, let's declare it today.
And the greater the storm, the louder our song. Yes, the greater the storm, the louder our song. We'll never stop singing. We'll never stop singing. We'll never stop singing. We'll never stop singing. We'll never stop singing.
Good morning. My name is Misty, and we're so glad that you're here today. Our mission as Gateway Church is to help people to take a step in the right direction, and we hope to help you to do that today. This week, we're continuing our series called Welcome Home, and in the second week of our series, we're taking a look at spiritual life. As we welcome you home, we want to ask, can we get you anything? It's our desire that you receive and experience everything that you need for life and growth. We also want to welcome back our university and college students who have joined us this semester. Yes, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. I invite you to take a seat and take a look at this special video we have for you.
Ah!
Welcome home. One of my favorite parts was watching your faces as you saw that video for the first time. We were thinking our pastors should welcome us when we come on Sundays. What do you think? That would be good. I would like that. I'd be a little frightened, but I think it would go over well. If you are newer here, or maybe you've only been here once or twice before, we're so glad that you came. We love meeting new people. I do invite you, after our morning is done, to visit our guest services area in the atrium. We'd love to say hello and give you a free gift just as a thanks for coming. If you have any questions, then you can feel free to ask. Also, we have a large number of volunteers serving every week that make Sundays and midweek programs go so well. And so we just wanted to thank all of our volunteers, whether that's in the kitchen or the parking lot, the atrium, on stage, kids, youth ministry, you name it. So thank you so much to our volunteers. There are lots of opportunities to be involved, and we would love for you to join that volunteer team as well. I'm going to give you a few moments to say hello to those around you, so why don't we stand together and do that now, and we'll be right back.
Hold on to me as we go, as we roll down unfamiliar road, and although this wave is stringing us along, just know you're not alone, 'cause I'm gonna make this place your home.
Stand together. We're going to sing a couple more songs. As we sing this morning, I want to encourage you that no matter what you may be going through or facing, there is something that we can do together. and that is to lift up our voices and to call upon the Lord, because He hears our cry and He knows our situation. I want to encourage you today. Let's do what we sing about. Let's call on His name as we sing.
We need no other hiding place. Our hope is safe within Your name. This we know, this we know. You promise never to forsake. What You began, You will sustain. This we know, this we know. And I will call upon the Lord, for He alone is strong enough to save. Rise, your shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain. All of the heavens and the earth announce the fullness of Your word. This we know, this we know.
Come on, declare it today.
And every enemy will flee as we declare Your victory. This we know, this we know. And I will call upon the Lord, for He alone is strong enough to save. Rise, your shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken.
Something that's true today. Lift up your voice and let's sing it together.
Jesus' name will break every stronghold. Freedom is ours when we call His name. Jesus' name above every other. All hail the power of Jesus' name.
Sing it out.
Jesus' name will break every stronghold. Freedom is
so thankful today, God, that you have broken every chain and that our freedom is secure because of Jesus today. Lord, we need you today. We need you. We need your power and your presence. We need your grace and your mercy and your peace in our lives. We come to you today, Lord.
Lord, I come.
Today, I suppose that there is no more important statement that we could make today other than you are our defense, you are our righteousness, and we need you today. Lord, sometimes we think we're self-sufficient. Sometimes we think that we have what it takes on our own to handle or deal with anything that life throws our way. But Lord, today we want to acknowledge that we are weak, but in you we are strong. that we are defenseless, but in you, Lord, we have a defense. Lord, we are so unrighteous at times, many times, Lord, but today, Lord, you are our righteousness, and we need you. For when we are weak, in you, we are strong. Be our life today. Be our life today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for singing with us. You may be seated.
I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and receive our giving, where we take a portion of what God has blessed us with and give so many others can benefit as well. I encourage you to remember our Raise Our Roof campaign, where we're adding a second floor in order to invest in our students, our families, and our communities. Thank you so much for giving, and if you're new here today, please don't feel compelled to give. However, if you would like to, it's always welcome. 2 weeks ago, Pastor Dave shared with us the heart of the courses that we're offering here at Gateway, and if you missed that, we would encourage you to go onto our website or our app and take a look at that video. We have foundational courses, life application courses, and life-enriching courses and events. And we encourage you today to not leave before talking to a Next Step coach in the atrium and registering for a course. And don't forget that you can register right through our app. Next Sunday, there will be a free seminar called Get Cyber Smart, presented by the founders of Cyber Smart Canada, which will equip families with tools and tips to teach their kids about cyber safety and responsibility. I'm having trouble saying cyber smart safety over and over again, but such an important topic. It's going to be presented at our Komoka campus at 6 p.m. There's no need to sign up. Just come on out. And as well, this Saturday, Pastor Rick is doing a leadership development and coaching seminar, so I'm going to turn it over to him to share the details of that.
Thank you, Missy. So many great things that are happening at Gateway Church, and 4 or 5 times a year, we want to offer this is an opportunity for you to expand, to grow, and to develop your leadership skills. And people will sometimes look at this, and that's kind of why I'm kind of bringing some understanding to it. They'll say, well, I'm really not a leader. If you're in a position of influence, leadership is influence. And one of the things that I have learned in my years as I've developed as a pastor and as a leader within the community is that you're always a student of leadership. Because if leadership is influence, you're always expanding that sphere of influence, whether it be at school, whether it be at work or at play, or even if it's within your own family, you're always influencing somebody. And so 4 or 5 times a year, I get together with those who regard themselves as wanting to increase their understanding and sharpen their leadership skills and spend some time with them. So this is open to anybody, not just those who serve in the church. But if you want to just grow your leadership and your influence skills with one another, then we will work together. It's just a couple of hours on a Saturday morning. We do this 4 or 5 times a year. I want to encourage you to come on out to that. And as well, our Pursuit Conference 2016 is fast coming up. We are so excited about it. We've entitled this year, we've called it Face to Face. Now, where did that title come from? Well, in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, the Bible talks about the fact that when we turn our face to God, He turns His face towards us. And when we see Him face to face, we will be changed and transformed. And so Pursuit Weekend is an opportunity for us, regardless of your age, to get together as a family. We used to call it retreat. We used to call it in a getting away overflow and some of the other experiences that young adults have and young people have. Well, we wanted to do a church-wide get-together where we as a family come together and set aside Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, morning and evening, Friday night, Saturday morning, Saturday night, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and we get together to just shut the clock off and just listen and wait on God. So we're excited about this weekend coming up. We want you, I know there's so many things that are calling for your attention, but we believe spiritual growth and development this aspect of your family life is most important. Yes, hockey's important. Yes, soccer's important. Yes, you know, chores around the house and getting your pool closed, those things maybe are important, but they're not as important as your spiritual life. Can someone say amen to that? So we want to encourage you to say, you know what, as a family, we're going to prioritize this weekend. We're going to come together as a family. Bring your kids. We got guest speakers for our kids. They're going to do a wonderful job. We have Brent Catalan coming from Life Church in British Columbia is going to be flying in. Fantastic speaker. It's going to be a great, great weekend. So we want to invite you to put that time aside. We'll get together and we will just experience God face to face. God bless you, and we'll continue on. Thank you.
Well, good morning. Wouldn't you love to experience what we just saw there? Like, accepted, cared for, knowing that you're loved by God, knowing that no matter what, you belong and you have purpose. What a great description of coming home, of spiritual life and health, really. Who wouldn't want to have all of that? But I think the reality is that all those beautiful qualities and ingredients, they don't just happen automatically when you walk through the doors on a Sunday morning. Or they don't just immediately take over our lives when we accept Christ. Experiencing all of that to truly embrace the welcome home that video described, it's not just about Gateway Church or everything or everyone around you. It's also about what's on the inside of us, our spiritual life. Because you're here at Gateway, as your pastors, we have a responsibility and really it's our privilege, it's our high calling to provide opportunities and to encourage you on your journey of spiritual life and health. Sorry, I'm just gonna get arranged here. My wife says I flail, so anything that's close is gonna get it. So it's who I am. I mean, you know, old dog, new tricks, that whole thing. Sue and I went to, just a couple of weeks ago, we went to see the movie Ben-Hur. And it was set back in the days just before Christ's crucifixion in Jerusalem. And three or four times throughout the movie, they showed Jesus speaking into situations, into people's lives, into crowds with words of life and forgiveness and hope. And Pilate, who was the Roman prefect for Judea, he witnesses Jesus intervening to protect a man that the crowd was stoning. And so Jesus actually bends over the man and uses his body as a shield as the crowd is pelting rocks at this man. And as Jesus is crouched over this man, he looks at the crowd and they're filled with anger and judgment and vengeance in a way and violence. And he starts talking to them about love and forgiveness and hope that those things are more powerful, that's what they need to embrace, not the anger of the moment. And the crowd, they start dropping their rocks because Jesus had something. When he spoke, it landed in people's lives. And Pilate, he turns to the captain next to them. They were on horseback, and he turns to his captain, and he says, "This Jesus and his message of love and forgiveness is more of a threat to Rome than the rebellion and the murderous attacks of the zealots." Pilate had no idea that what he had witnessed was spiritual life. Jesus came to bring life. And I know that's just a scene from a movie, but we also see it in the eyewitness accounts of Jesus' life when he walked on earth. There was something different about him that mankind had never seen before. Even when he was a child, religious leaders, it says that they were astonished at the way that Jesus spoke. Everywhere he went, people took notice of him. Stories circulated. Did you hear? He turned water into wine. I've heard about miracles of healing and people's lives being changed and just the way he speaks and the love that he talks about. There was one man, his name was Nicodemus. He was sort of a religious leader, teacher kind of guy, and he had heard the stories. In fact, he had witnessed some of the miracles. And finally, he has to know more about this Jesus. Something in his heart pushed him to risk his reputation, his position in society. But he has to find out how to get what this Jesus had. So Nicodemus goes to Jesus at night in secret. And Jesus, again, he just has this way. He sees Nicodemus's heart. He sees that he's searching for more. And Jesus says to him, Nicodemus, unless you are born again, unless God births something new in your life, it's not possible for you to understand what I'm talking about when I talk about the kingdom, when I talk about there being more to life. Jesus was pointing to a life, a spiritual life that begins when a person is born again. It's this sparked to life moment when you get saved. But then from that moment on, there's this journey that each one of us have to take, this spiritual life that it has to stay fresh. It has to grow and be fed and get strong. If you're here this morning and you have questions, maybe just like Nicodemus, or maybe you find yourself attending Gateway and you sort of enjoy Sunday mornings. You enjoy the music, the worship, the speaking, and all the video and all that. And, you know, it's sort of good, but you're not so sure if what Jesus was pointing Nicodemus to, if you've really experienced that birthing, that coming to life spiritually. But we want to help you with that, if that's you this morning. It's actually one of the most important things that we could ever do here. We've created an opportunity specifically for people just like you. Our Alpha course that's beginning in just the next few weeks, it unpacks that first step. Now, it answers questions. We believe that this is so important. It's actually one of our foundational courses. It's led by Pastor Blair. Be a Nicodemus. Get the answers that you need and experience life, spiritual life. When Jesus called his disciples to, you know, initially to join him, he didn't say, here, you know, take this test and we'll see how you do. Or he didn't say, submit a resume and I'll take a look at it and I'll get back to you. He didn't ask them about their synagogue attendance. You know what he says to them? Two words. Follow me. Watch what I do. Listen to what I say. Experience the God moments when I speak into someone's life because the Father shares all things with me. Come and follow me. You know, Jesus, it says, came to seek and to save the lost. And that speaks of forgiveness of sins. But it also speaks of being found, of being brought into a brand new way of living life. He came to bring life, overflowing life, spiritual life. There was this rich young guy, and after he had watched Jesus' life, he comes to Jesus and he says, how do I get this kind of life? The life that, this eternal life that you're talking about. He said, I've watched you. Can I earn that? Jesus sees this young man's heart. He sees that he has made riches and money his first love. And so Jesus answers the young man and he says, if you will go and sell everything that you have, just give it to the poor, then come and follow me. In other words, you can't buy it, you can't earn it, just follow me and I'll show you what life is really all about. Jesus was inviting this young man to experience spiritual life. And folks, that invitation has never changed. It's for every one of us here this morning. One final story from Scripture. There's this hardcore Jew named Saul or Paul. He had all the formal religious education that there was in that day. He devoted his life to learning the Scriptures and the religious traditions, the law, the rules. Paul was bent on persecuting followers of Christ and even anything to do with Christ. He believed that he was a defender of everything good and right, and he was really just this model Jew, if you will. Just a side note, I've been in church all my life. I'm sure from the first week of my life. My mom was the choir and director and organist, and my dad was the song leader, so where else would I be but in the front row, I'm sure. The longer I've been in church, I've come to this conclusion that the longer that you're a Christian, the more you think that you're doing all the right things, the longer and more comfortable you are in church, hanging out with church people, talking church talk, the greater the risk of you becoming like a Paul before his conversion. Religious pride is one of the deadliest enemies of spiritual life, and it only attacks church people. God had to get Paul's attention. He had to literally knock him out of his spiritual pride. And so one day after Christ had been crucified and rose from the grave, Paul was riding along a road and the risen Christ knocks him to the ground with a blinding light. And Christ says to Paul, "Why are you persecuting me?" Paul looks up and he says, "Who are you?" "I'm Jesus, the one that you have been persecuting." What Paul experienced that day was a life-changing experience that transformed the rest of his life. It was the beginning. It was his first step of many more to come to truly embrace and experience spiritual life. See, Paul had knowledge. He had studied the Scriptures under the best teachers. He was compassionate for his religion. He was 100% committed to what he believed. But he was bound in his own pride. He was a prisoner and he was blind to the truth. He was spiritually dead. The risen Christ invited Paul to step out and to follow him. Did you know that you can attend church, you can know the Scriptures, you can even be a leader, and yet not experience spiritual life to the fullest? Later in his life, after Paul had humbled himself, after he had been led by Christ, after he learned what it was to listen to God's voice and to walk in the Spirit, he wrote these words. He says, "Anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun." God invites each one of us not only to receive forgiveness and a new start, but he invites us. He wants to lead every one of us into this incredible, brand new way of living life. Are you following him? Are you living a new life in the Spirit? You know, every one of our courses here at Gateway are basically your pastors saying, trust us, take your next step, follow us as we follow Christ. And that's not puffing us up. It really puts us on the line. We need to be following Christ. If we're not, you're in trouble. Just want to say that. But we want to encourage you. Take your next step. Turn to the person next to you and say, there's more for me. I've just begun. I still remember the day as a pastor that I discovered my absolute need for spiritual life. And I was a pastor when I discovered it. I had been actually pastoring for 10 years. That was 20 years ago. Can anyone say, my, is he ever young? Thank you. I was pastoring our first church that we were lead pastor of in a small town north of Toronto called Keswick, on the shores of Lake Simcoe. Our little church was a collection of people that were some teachers and businessmen. Actually, there was one teacher, there were two businessmen, and then there were others that were a mixture of single parent families, people on welfare, and most of our congregation were first generation Christians. They loved Jesus. They loved us. Look at our new pastor and his little boys coming to just love on us. That sort of tells you how long ago it was, too. Our little boys aren't little anymore. The first year that we pastored that little church, I preached my heart out. I counseled. We loved on those people. We Bible studied them. We fellowshipped. We did everything we knew to do. And after a year, Sue and I realized that it seemed like we were just maintaining church services. It was nice and everybody loved everybody, but there was something missing. The ones that were hurting or broken, they weren't getting any better. And the normal ones, the religious or the church people, it seemed like they were just going through the motions. It's like they were on autopilot. They were zombies for Jesus. If that's possible. Sorry. You know, I really believe that God had called us to that church. I refuse to just play church. Our call to ministry, it wasn't just to play pastor. Sue and I sold everything that we could possibly sell to go to Bible school. But after a year, I was so frustrated and discouraged. I didn't have any answers. But I knew that God had us there. I called one of my spiritual fathers, Stuart Hunter, and I said, where does a pastor go to get answers, to get equipped? I really enjoyed my 4 years of Bible school, but and those are foundational years and awesome and wonderful. But I needed answers, and I just didn't seem to have what it took to help these people that God had entrusted into my care. Well, this pastor said, well, there's a couple of pastors' conferences that you could go to down in the States. Long story short, there was one that was put on by Pastor Jack Hayford in Los Angeles. And to be honest, we chose Los Angeles because it was the one furthest south. Our little congregation, they scraped up enough money for our airfare, but there was absolutely not a dime extra. The church, Pastor Jack's church, they heard of our plight, and so they had a scholarship fund for pastors just like us. So they paid for our registration for the conference, and then they provided a billet out to one of their spiritual leaders, one of their elders at their church, and they put us up for the week. 2 weeks before we were to fly down to this conference, we get a call from the couple that we're going to stay in their homes. And it was Roger on the phone. He introduced himself and small talk. And then finally he says, So, can I ask you why you're attending Pastor Jack's pastor's conference? Well, I'm a pretty transparent guy, and I responded that God entrusted us with these precious people, but I really don't know how to help them. I'm desperate. So Roger, he says, well, he said, Pastor Jack has this special retreat after pastor's conference that he invites pastors to stay and attend. He says, if you can arrange to stay an extra few days, we'd like you to be our guest at this retreat. Well, Sue and I heard the word retreat. And in our past, that meant Muskoka Woods or Camp Modiba. So we packed our tennis rackets and our hiking boots. Well, pastor's conference was incredible. It started on the Sunday, went to the Wednesday. Jack Hayford, Rick Warren, incredible worship, long days, amazing content. We were exhausted. Our ears were sore from hearing so many good words all day. And we would come home every night from this conference just exhausted. And Roger and Barbara, they would feed a supper, but then they would sit us down in their living room, and this may date things a little bit, but they plugged in a VHS tape. And they said, these are the teachings that will, they talk about living in the Spirit, and they're going to prepare you for this spiritual life retreat on the weekend. And so we would sit there, and to be honest, I fell asleep. I was so tired, I fell asleep. They woke me up at one point and said, okay, now you need to serve your wife communion. And I'm like, what did I miss? Yeah. But there was something about this couple, this Roger and Barbara. Oh my goodness. It was like they were so full of Jesus. Both Sue and I, we wanted to be like them. We wanted what they had. So long story short, the retreat wasn't in the mountains. It was at the Burbank Hilton Hotel. It was a cleansing stream retreat for people who had been taking this Living in the Spirit course, just like the one we're offering you this fall. Roger saved us seats right in the front row of this grand ballroom. There were 1,500 people in attendance. The worship ministered to us like God was preparing us for something. We had no idea, no sweet clue. Then one of the first speaker got up, one of the pastors from Pastor Jack's church, and I've never heard a sermon like that. He talked to every one of the speakers. They talked about some of the things that hold us back from experiencing spiritual life. And at the end of a talk, they they would say, okay, now we're going to lead you in a prayer. So Sue and I, you know, we would bow our heads and close our eyes, and because that's what you're taught in Bible school. And they would start with this prayer that you repeat after them. Oh my goodness, the mother of all prayers. It was the longest prayer that I had ever heard. I was so tempted to peek, but it was powerful too. It was different. At the end of the prayer, we open our eyes and look up, and we're in the front row, and across the front of this grand ballroom, there's 150 prayer warriors, and they're inviting us to come forward, that in light of what the teaching that we just heard, if God is speaking to us and there's something in our lives that they just want to agree together with us in prayer, they invited us to come forward for personal prayer. You know what? After growing up in the church, both of us, my parents, both, in fact, Sue's dad, my dad, and mom, both attended a Pentecostal Bible school. Sue's grandfather started King Street Pentecostal Church in Oshawa. My grandfather started Campbellford Pentecostal Church in Campbellford. There we go. How many know where that is? If you're not from Eastern Ontario, not a chance. After pastoring for 10 years with that pedigree, you would think that we would have a pretty good handle on this spiritual life thing, and because we're leaders, what God began to do in Sue and my life at that retreat, it introduced us to spiritual life like we've never experienced before. And we're still on that journey. God started to gently point to stuff in our lives. There was a residue of past sin. It's not that we weren't forgiven for it, but there was this residue that just needed to be dealt with. There were attitudes and ways of thinking and emotions and hurts in our lives that, you know, they'd just been sort of covered over with time and other stuff. And after a while, you get comfortable with your stuff and you begin to believe the lie, one of the deadliest lies to spiritual life, is when we believe that, well, this is just the way I am. It's the way God created me. And I used to use that as a defense when I would have a reaction to something that wasn't very pretty. Well, it's just the way God made me. Well, I'm better than I used to be. We realized that we really had no idea how to live in the Spirit. Whew. We went back to our little congregation. We stood up that next Sunday morning and we simply told them what God had begun to do in our lives. And almost every adult raised their hand and said, I don't know what that is, but that's what we need. For the next 7 years, we watched God absolutely transform us first, but then our little church. The spiritual life of our church became fun and exciting to be a part of. People began to take their next steps, and there were miracles of transformation. We began to reach the students and the children in our community. Jeff Price, the pastor at Woodstock, he was our youth pastor. Melissa McLaren, Angie's sister, was our worship leader, and we began Sue began a ladies' community group, and it's just so it reminds me of what Angie is doing here during the week in community. Word spread into our community, and before long, we had to rent a local movie theater for our Sunday morning services. I was at a local district conference. Actually, it was in Ottawa. We lived in Keswick. And we went out to lunch with one of the guys that I graduated from Bible college with. And like Sue and I are just bubbling of the journey that we're on. It's just exciting, and we sure hadn't arrived, but God was doing fresh things in our lives and in the lives of our people. And so we're sharing this, and we looked across the table, and here's this pastor in tears. And he shared with us, he said, "You guys have no idea." He said, "Just last week, I was in my office." He said, I've just been getting beat up by the power brokers in my church, the people that know better and are religious and all that stuff. And he said, "I grabbed my keys, I got into my car." He says, "I drove down to the harbor." He says, "I drove out this cement pier that goes way out into Lake Ontario. I drove out to the end of that pier, and," he said, "I wanted to take my life." He says, "I would have if I hadn't chickened out." We prayed with that pastor that day, and God began to stir a hope. All of a sudden, his eyes began to open, that he wasn't wrestling against flesh and blood, that there was something that was trying to snuff out the life that he was called to bring to that community that he was in. He went home like a man on a mission. He dragged his whole pastoral staff and his wonderful board. He dragged them up to Keswick every night, every week, to go through Living in the Spirit, a 3-hour drive. Took them through Living in the Spirit, and then we had to drive to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania for the closest retreat. He trucked them down there, and God started bringing life into his church. And that pastor is successfully pastoring to this day. Praise God. Other churches began to hear that there was something was going on, and within a year, there were over 200 people traveling down to Pittsburgh for these retreats. They were hungry for spiritual life. Are you hungry for spiritual life? Are you experiencing a fresh, growing spiritual life? Don't settle for lukewarm. Did you know that spiritual life has an enemy? His name is Satan, and he will do whatever he can to keep you from stepping forward on your spiritual journey. Scripture says that Jesus came to bring life, abundant spiritual life. But Satan comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. Is the enemy trying to steal what rightfully belongs to you? Is he trying to kill the love in your life, the joy, the peace, the hope? Is he trying to destroy the relationships in your life? Jesus came so that we would experience life. This is a little bit old school, but would you just bow your heads? I'm just closing. I just find it easier when it's just me and God. I just close my eyes and it's just me and him. How many here this morning would say by raising your hand, Pastor, I want to experience more of that spiritual life. I know that there is more that God has for me. Can I see your hand? Is there anyone in this place? Yes. Yes. Hands all across this place. Yes. Thank you for being so honest. Yes. Thank you. Yes. Now another question. But this time I want you to ask God, God, what's my next step? God, what do you want? What's my next step to follow you? I really believe for some of you, there's someone in your family, someone that's close to you. And this step, this decision, it's not even just about you, but God's wanting to reach someone close to you through you. But you've got to take a step. Lord, I just want to commit every man, every woman, every student in this place into your hands. God, I thank you that what you begin when our lives are sparked to life, spiritual life, that you want to lead us and walk us through the journey to completion. Lord, thank you that you see every decision that was made in this place this morning. And God, I pray every person that committed to something today, that raised their hand, Lord, before you, may they commit right now to taking that step. Whatever it takes, whatever that step is, whatever that means, God, may they commit that before you. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, when we offer courses every fall, every winter and spring season, what we're really doing, and sometimes I feel like people, as soon as we start saying something about a course and a sign up, it goes somewhere. It's like it's dismissed for many different reasons. But the reason that we offer every course that we offer, it's like it's an invitation for you to experience more of the spiritual life that God has for you. Whether it's Alpha or Living in the Spirit or Foundations in Faith or Community or Love and Respect or Growing Kids, there's so many. That all of them, their sole purpose is for your spiritual life and health. There's a table out in the atrium, across the atrium. There are leaders that are there. They're waiting for you right now. They want to help answer any questions that you have. What's my next step? How do I sign up? What's involved? Jesus said, simply follow me. Folks, it's your decision. But be assured, following Christ is the best decision that you will ever make. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Dave. Well, I hope that spoke to you this morning. I know that spiritual life craving that we all have kind of deep in our guts for more. I'm going to give you a few minutes to turn to someone next to you and share a little bit about these questions. Whether or not the Lord spoke to you right now. Some of you know what your next step is, and some of you need to seek the Lord a little bit more. So just take some time to answer these questions. I believe that what I need most in my spiritual life is, and I think my next step may be. So go ahead and do that, and we'll be back in a minute. I love hearing the conversation. We hope it continues after you leave today. Thank you for being with us. We hope you had a great experience. If you wouldn't mind helping us to stack the chairs 10 high and move them toward that side of the atrium, we would appreciate it. Have a great week, and we'll see you next Sunday.